Welcome to the American Humanist Association's Speaking of Humanism series. My name is Emily Newman, and I'm the AHA Senior Education Coordinator. Today, I'm happy we are joined by Tracy Swinton Bailey, author of Forever Free, A True Story of Hope in the Fight for Child Literacy. Tracy earned a PhD in education with a specialization in language and literacy at the University of South Carolina in 2013. She began her career as a high school English instructor and went on to found Freedom Readers, an after-school and summer literacy program that was designed and implemented to support families in low-income areas and assist children in achieving their academic goals in reading. She is married to award-winning writer Isaac J. Bailey and is the mother of two children. So thank you again for joining us today, Tracy, and I will let you take it away.
Thank you so much, Emily. I'm very excited to be here with you this evening. I've been looking forward to this opportunity to speak with you for quite some time now. So thank you again for the invitation. As Emily said, my name is Tracy Swinton Bailey. My book, Forever Free, is a memoir and it's a call to action. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the memoir part first. And while I'm doing that, I'm going to offer some solutions for helping young people improve their literacy skills. So when I was growing up, I was surrounded by books. There were books everywhere in my home, as far as I can remember. My parents did a really good job of buying the kind of books that I think they may have known that I would gravitate to. I had a lot of Dr. Seuss books. I had a book called Lyle, Lyle, Crocodile that I absolutely loved. And my favorite book when I was growing up was a book called There's a Monster at the End of This Book. It was a Sesame Street book that featured a blue furry monster by the name of Grover. And Grover kept saying, please don't turn the page. My dad would read this book to me just about every night. And whenever Grover said, don't turn the page, I would grab his hand and tell him not to turn the page. But when we got to the end of the book, we found out that the monster at the end of the book was Grover himself. And that just absolutely cracked me up when I was a little girl. I laughed and laughed and always begged my father to read that book to me again. He would tell me to go to sleep and we could read it the next day. But those moments, I think, just really instilled in me just the love for the written word, the love for the kind of emotions that books could evoke, even when I was very, very young. So the first solution that I want to offer to you is whatever children you have in your life, whether they be your own children, nieces, nephews, cousins, give them books. Give them the opportunity to be surrounded by books and immersed in words. I think that's the thing that really helps readers become readers. You can build a habit of reading just by having access to those books around you, and you gravitate to the ones that really spark your interest. When I was growing up in the 70s, my parents, I don't think they really had much access to books that featured little girls and little boys that looked like me. And so now that I run an organization called Freedom Readers, it is just one of my great joys and pleasures to be able to select the kinds of books that I wish I had when I was growing up, the kinds of books that look like a lot of the young people with whom I work at Freedom Readers. So if you don't mind, I am going to spend a couple of minutes telling you about some of these books that we explore at Freedom Readers right now. The first one I want to share with you is called I Love My Hair. And as you can see, the braids are flying all over the cover of this book, and it just feels very joyful to me. And so what I want to do is present for the young people in our program images that reflect them, that are joyful, images that let them know that they're beautiful and that they're brilliant, and that whatever it is that they're doing and engaged in at the time, it's something that is extremely special. So I Love My Hair is one of our favorite books to take a look at. Another book that we enjoy is called I Affirm Me, The ABCs of Inspiration for Black Kids. And so here we get to hear messages that encourage us, that inspire us. And we also, again, get to see these images of young people that look like probably 70 to 80% of the young people with whom we work at Freedom Readers. It is just so great to be able to see that the publishing world is embracing more writers of color for children's books, and more illustrators of color. So if you look at the cover of this book, you see that there is a variety of hues, a variety of skin tones, and that's something very important to us when we share books with the young people in our program. The next book I want to share with you is called Stay This Way Forever by Lindsay Davis. Lindsay happens to be a journalist. And in this book, she writes about a child who is in the middle of discovering the world, and she highlights that innocence and that enthusiasm that comes with childhood. As I researched a little bit more about this book, I found that she was inspired by her own son, and she wanted to say to her son, stay this way forever. Stay, keep the sense of awe. Stay excited, stay enthusiastic about life. So this is another one of the books that I love to share with the kids at our after-school program. The last book that I'm gonna share with you for right now is called Silway. And I don't know if you've heard of this one, but it's written by a celebrity. Lupita Nyong'o is an actress. But what I really like about this book is that the main character in this book is thinking about the way that she looks. And she's thinking about the way that the world looks at her. And it's not always kind, the feedback that she receives from the world. And I really connected with this book. It resonated with me because as I write in Forever Free, there was a time when I thought a lot about the way that I looked and the feedback that I got from people around me, and how that impacted the way that I saw the world. So just holding this book in my hands right now, it encourages me, it excites me, because I know that I'll be able to connect with a young girl who probably is also struggling with trying to figure out where she fits into the world. That's what I think that children's books can do for us. That's what I think that reading does for all of us. It gives us a sense of our humanity. It helps us remember to connect to those things that are common for all of us. Those universal feelings of not necessarily belonging and growing into who we are supposed to be. I talk about books in Forever Free as being my mentors. They're voices that kind of help me shape who I would be as an adult and what I would end up becoming in the world. So I've told you a lot about what we do at Freedom Readers. So now I want to take a couple of minutes and just kind of describe for you what this thing is that I've been talking about. Freedom Readers is an after-school and summer literacy program that I started in 2010. And we will accept as many as 20 young people. We call them scholars when they come to work with us. And we will recruit about 20 people in our community who love reading and enjoy the opportunity to interact with kids. Our meetings are 90 minutes a week, and we meet in community centers, we meet in churches, and we also meet in school buildings. Our meetings are kind of linked together in about an 8 to 10 week session, and each one of these sessions has a theme. Our theme for the summer session was, how does your garden grow? So we talked a lot about agriculture. We like to bring in vocabulary words that kids may not have heard before, and we'd like to expose them to things that might be new and exciting. So at the beginning of each one of these meetings that we have in a session, we will have a theme song, and that theme song will give us the opportunity to kind of laugh and sing and play, But we also have the words to that theme song flashed on a screen or in a booklet where the kids can follow along and put their finger on every word. The reason that we do this is because I remember when I was a child, growing up in church, we would sing these songs and I would have my hymn book in front of me. And I learned to pronounce a lot of words from that hymn book and from that experience of singing those songs, hearing those words and making that connection to what was written on the page. That was a really important part of my development as a reader. And so I include that in the Freedom Readers program. Once we get through our theme song, we might watch a video or read a book that's related to that particular theme. During the How Does Your Garden Grow session, we brought in some earthworms to allow the kids to feel what a worm might feel like on their palm and how important worms are in gardening and helping get the soil ready to grow new things. And so that was an exciting experience for us. We read about bumblebees and butterflies and organic vegetables, and all of these things, I think, really opened a lot of doors for the scholars. We had a garden that was actually growing where they could go in and pick sunflower seeds and help pull weeds. And we talked about the connection between gardening and that actual plot of land and being able to garden our environments around us. Sometimes we need to remove distractions so that we can focus on our studies and do a good job, the same way that we need to remove weeds from a garden so that our vegetables can grow well. So those are our whole group discussions. We break there for a little bit of a snack. And during snack time, we allow scholars and tutors to have conversations about their day or about vocabulary words or about gardens in general. And then we move into a 45-minute section of our time together where scholars and tutors read together. We ask tutors to pull a book from our shelves that might be a book that is of interest to the scholar with whom they're working. That book might be a little bit above their reading level, but the tutor is going to be reading aloud to the young person so they get to hear about something that they're interested in and get to discover more about it without really having to be above their operational reading level. And then we ask all of the scholars to choose a book that's within their reading zone, something they're comfortable with. That gives them the opportunity to practice what they've learned in school. And so we spend some time giving the tutor an opportunity to listen to them read, to help them discover some of the words they might be struggling with, and to help them grow their fluency and comprehension. They have conversations around those books. And then the tutor and scholar begin to work on public speaking skills. This is one of my favorite parts of the Freedom Readers program. We give all of the young people an opportunity to look at a template, fill in that template, and then practice with their tutor first what it's like to give a speech. So these speeches might be 2 to 4 minutes long in the beginning, but each one of them gets a chance to stand there in front of 40 people in some cases and deliver this speech. We talk to them about making eye contact and projecting their voices and using lots of enthusiasm. And I think that these lessons stick with the kids week after week. And then by the time we get to the last week of a session, we see that a lot of the kids are wanting to be the first ones to participate in the public speaking. Right before we leave, we remind all of our scholars to pick up a book from the take-home table. And they might see a book like Ada Twist Scientist, and then they can choose this book if science is something that really interests them, take it home with them and add it to their home libraries. We've read a lot of research that says that when you have more books in your home, you're more likely to spend more time reading those books and you're actually more likely to perform better academically. So that is what our Freedom Readers weekly programs look like. I believe this is another solution for improving child literacy. Just pulling people together from across lots of barriers, socioeconomic lines, from racial barriers, from different communities. People come together to support these children, to help them reach their full potential. And I really think in our communities, we need more and more opportunities for folks to set aside the things that separate us, the things that call attention to our differences, and allow us to come together under the banner of a really important goal. And the goal at Freedom Readers is to help kids move forward. So I also want to tell you about what I've written about in my book for people who might be wanting other solutions and things that they can do at home. What I understand and what I've come to understand since I founded this organization and have been working with it is that schools are not going to be the 100% solution for every student that walks through the door. It's our responsibility as people in the community, as folks who have had the opportunity to really benefit from a good education, to give back. And these are some of the things that we can do to give back. And again, this is with any child that's in your life. The first thing I recommend is that you receive. I call these my five R's for helping to improve child literacy. When I say receive, I mean, take the time to sit next to a child and just listen to what they have to say to you about their interest. So what we've developed is something called an interest inventory, and it allows kids to tell you about their favorite colors, their favorite movies, the kinds of books they like, their favorite songs, the things that they like to do in their spare time. And I think that sometimes when we're working with kids, we tend to really just dive in and start to look at books and have discussions about literacy and reading and writing. But the first step, I think, is actually being open to receiving what it is that they want to tell us. Whenever I've asked kids to help me fill out the interest inventory, they've always had so many good things to share with me. And what's been very interesting to me is that I could give an interest inventory in, let's say, January, and turn around and give that same interest inventory in August of the same year. And the kid and I are both discovering that they've changed in so many different ways. So receiving is the first R that I want to leave you with. The second R is research. Once you know what a child likes to read, what they're interested in, then that's when we can spend time on the internet, in a library, in a bookstore, just researching what's out there that can connect with that child. I believe that when we find the just right book that will spark the curiosity of a child, then it's hard to get them to stop reading. But we do have to do our research so we know what kinds of books that we can recommend. The third R that I offer is record. And one of the resources in the book and on the Freedom Readers website is a record keeper where you can write the names of books that you're reading with children. And then after a while, you can look back on the number of pages you've read, the kinds of books that you've been reading. And then you can say, oh, this child might really like this series of books, or, oh, they're really fascinated by this particular author. And then you can go and find more books by that author and allow the child to continue to grow in that area. The fourth R that I want to leave you with is read aloud. Reading aloud is something so incredibly important, even when you think a child is too old to be read to. Especially young kids who are developing their own voices in their heads, reading aloud for them allows them to hear your voice as they're reading along. It really is a great fluency builder. And even as an adult, I enjoy being read to. Speaking of which, the audiobook of Forever Free is also available. And I did have the opportunity to read the book aloud. And it was quite a journey and an experience to look at all the things that I write about from a different perspective, not just as a writer, but also as a reader. The last R that I want to leave you with is respond. I firmly believe that reading is a social act. And when you read something that is interesting to you, something that really sparks your imagination, or something that you think that you strongly agree with, or something that you totally disagree with, you want to talk to someone about it. Being in a book club or being around other people, I think is just really something special and integral to a reading life. So what we do for kids is we offer them a lot of different opportunities to respond. They might draw a picture where they respond to something that they've read, or they might write a poem, or they might pull out just some key words that they've seen in the book and incorporate that into a speech and share that with the people in the group. So those five R's are really important, I think, as we are improving child literacy. We need to remember to receive, research, record, read aloud, and respond. I have a couple more books here that I want to share with you that we take a look at Freedom Readers. This book is by Jacqueline Woodson, and she is one of my favorite authors. She's written books for adults, and she's written books for young adults, and this is one of her books for children. It's called The Day You Begin, and it kind of describes a time where you go into a situation and you look around and you realize that you might be the only person like you in the room. You think that's the case until you begin to tell your story and you listen to other people's stories. And so this book I like to share with young people to help them get acclimated and comfortable and relaxed in a setting like a Freedom Reader setting, so people can get to know one another. This book is called Hair Love. And remember, the first book I shared with you was I Love My Hair. But the thing that I love about this book, it was written by a former NFL football player. And what he does is highlight the relationship between an African-American dad and his daughter. And he learns to do her hair in this book. And so it's really a happy and triumphant kind of picture book that you can share with all kids to help them really reflect on that particular relationship. The last book that I'm going to share with you today is called Respect. So we know that there is a movie coming out soon about the life of Aretha Franklin. And this book kind of helps young people get to experience who she was and the impact that she had on American music. We love to look at biographies, and we invite the young people in our program also to write about themselves or to write about people who are important in their lives. What I want to point out here is Carol Boston Weatherford is the author, and she's written many children's books that I really, really enjoy. So that just gives you a taste of what we do at Freedom Readers, what Freedom Readers is about. And I hope that gives you a little bit of insight into how this organization came to be. I believe that the fact that I was surrounded by those books and my dad took the time to sit and read with me, that had the kind of impact on my life that, you know, I really can't undersell that. I can't say enough about the fact that he took the time to do that for me. I also write a lot in the book about Frederick Douglass, because as an enslaved person, he understood the importance of reading. And it was the wife of the plantation owner where he was enslaved that actually taught him how to read. And so he said the words, "Once you learn to read, you are forever free," because he understood the transformative power of being able to pick up a book and being able to be transported by that particular book. He also understood, though, that knowledge makes a man or a person unfit to be a slave. And so what I'm hoping is that through this program, through the conversations that we have with young people, that doors will swing wide for them in their minds and in the world. And so that's one of my major goals with this work, to create a space that's safe for them to be able to explore academically, but also to be able to confront the ideas that will help them change the world. So thank you so much for listening to my explanation of our program and talk a little bit about the book that I wrote. And so Emily, I'll invite you to come back in and share any questions that might have been brought to the surface as I spoke.
Thank you so much, Tracy. I honestly loved all of those R ideas that you put forward and was collecting them. And I feel that essence of responsibility for the people around us and the future generations to come, it definitely resonates with the work that we do. Speaking of those recommendations, when you mentioned the research part about kind of taking the child's interest and looking into them, do you recommend that adults do like some pre-research before they bring the child into it? Or is it all about exploring with the child?
So that's a very good question, Emily. I'm glad you asked that. When I said research, I really feel like the research needs to come after the receiving. Mm-hmm. So we're going to research based on what it is the child tells us that they're interested in. One of the things that I've noticed about working in schools is that literacy educators in schools often are handed a curriculum that they feel is going to be beneficial for helping to move a child forward. But research also tells us that when kids have the opportunity to choose what they're going to read, then 9 times out of 10, they're more engaged in the reading. And as a result, they spend more time working on figuring out how to become a better reader. So the receiving, I think, needs to come first, and then the research based on what the kids provide to us is a very important next step.
Yeah, and I think that empowering the children to know how that they can further research and, you know, continue to seek answers and feel comfortable asking questions. I loved the mention about the receiving, because I think that especially with a new relationship with a child, mm-hmm. needs to prove that, you know, you're not there to just throw information at them. You're there to absorb and get to them and their interests, and really see them as developing individuals. I know that sometimes people talk about, you know, how we talk to children and we don't mm-hmm. want to talk down to them. Maybe simplify our language, but certainly be comforting them in knowing that we see them fully.
Absolutely, Emily. I think everybody wants to be seen. Everybody wants to be heard. So just by sitting there and asking questions, I think kids pick up on the vibe that, okay, I'm supposed to be involved in this. I'm not just supposed to be sitting here and allowing somebody to pour knowledge into my head. I'm supposed to really be engaged in this process. And I think that that is really the only way that we can help kids improve their literacy, is by allowing them to bring all of their enthusiasm, all of their energy, all of their excitement to the process. There's another thing that I write about in the book that I think is really important. And I was reminded when you talked about how we relate to children. So a lot of our sites are established in public housing communities. And one thing that I talk to the tutors in our program about a lot is the fact that there's a difference between charity and a difference between radical care, right? And this is what I try to describe in the book. Charity, as some people approach it, is almost like I need to go into this setting and fill in some type of deficit that these children have. I need to fix something that's broken here. But radical care is the total opposite of that. I use a quote from Brian Stevenson in my book that talks about the fact that as human beings, we all experience some type of brokenness. We're all broken on some type of level. And so I invite the tutors in our program to come to us with the intention and with the mindset that you are walking alongside another human being. And together, we can help heal brokenness on both sides of the equation. So it's not like we're just looking down at this family or at this child. Maybe they don't have the same amount of money that you do, but that does not mean that they don't have a lot to bring to the table. And so we look for those strengths in every child and in every family, and we celebrate those, and we walk together towards all of our potential and all of our dreams as humans.
That's lovely, because also when we were preparing for this, and I mentioned about humanists value lifelong learning, I think it's especially important for children to know, like, you're not done learning once you're an adult. You don't know everything. You are always exploring, and brings them on that journey so that they see it more as a marathon than, you know, a race.
Absolutely.
So we do have a couple of questions, and I want to remind folks both on Zoom and Facebook that you can still submit questions, and we will try to get to as many as possible while we have Tracy with us. You had mentioned before about the importance of being able to hear and see the words as you're doing a story or a song, and finding ways to engage the children by having them interact. And I wonder if you want to say more about how you support children with different learning abilities in being able to absorb the information and, you know, and feel kind of more confident about it.
Yeah, one of the things that we really, one of our objectives is to really build that confidence in the young people that come to work with us. And so even if we're working with a kindergartner who isn't reading on their own, then we've got a person there who will read to them just about anything that they'd like to hear, as long as it's something that interests them. And so again, we focus them on the words, and we put our fingers on each and every word until young people feel a little bit more more confident and are more independent in reading without doing that. One thing that I've discovered, which is probably, I think, a benefit of having having had that time when we were at home together, lots of authors have recorded their books. And I just discovered recently on Netflix, I can watch a show called Bookmark, and I can watch Lupita Nyong'o read her book out loud in an 8-minute episode of that particular book. There are lots of different resources that we have that are video resources and just things that we can listen to that really help us continue to be surrounded by words. So even if a child has a learning disability and isn't reading at all on their own, we still invite them to be able to experience the joy of discovering a story, you know, the magic of being wrapped in a story.
Yeah, I saw, especially during COVID, more opportunities on like Facebook Live of celebrities reading. I know a child who's actually been reading some bedtime stories for people on Facebook, knowing, you know, that your parents may be busy, but you still deserve to have this kind of caring wrap up to your day each day.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And I know that teachers have recorded lots of books on YouTube. So these things are really very accessible to us right now. And audiobooks are also another really great way to be able to make that connection in your brain between the words on the page and what those words sound like.
So connected to the question about learning ability, we have, how do you assist kids with neurodevelopmental disorders such as ADHD manage their disorders while learning and reading?
So I think one of the great things about what we do at Freedom Readers is that we can connect one child and one tutor. So there is just an opportunity to develop a relationship and a partnership that can be very personalized and very specialized for that young person. One thing that we make sure that we do in our time together is we make sure that the environment is always high energy, but it's always very structured. And another R that I can throw in there is ritual. The young people know what to expect when they come to be with us because every meeting is structured the exact same way. So I know I have my own personal child has ADHD, and I know that those are some of the things that are extremely important. If I'm trying to hold your attention, I'm not going to try to do it for longer than I know that you can endure that. So we built in breaks in the 45 minutes that we're working together. We might go and do 20 jumping jacks and then come back and read a page. I might read a page to you, you read a page to me. We might just march around the room and come back, or we might read something and then write a little something. So we always make sure that we vary what it is that we're doing to try to build those literacy skills so that we don't lose anybody in the room.
So specifically connected to the Freedom Readers, we had someone on Facebook ask, is this something that is or can be sort of pre-packaged / guided to apply in another state? In other words, are you looking to expand the program, and how would we get involved?
So that's a wonderful question. Thank you for asking. We're definitely interested in expanding the program because the thing that really, the thing that motivates me is the fact that there are so many children who we say are not reading on grade level. We know that they do not have the foundation that they need to just go into the world and be successful. Without a strong foundation in literacy, research also tells us that a lot of the young people that we know are the most vulnerable are going to end up having an interaction with the juvenile justice system or just not being able to reach their full potential and satisfy their dreams. And so the person that asked that question, I would recommend that you visit us on our website at freedomreaders.org. There's an opportunity for you to connect with us there. I also highly recommend that you read the book. And once you are familiar with the model and are you think you're ready to establish something like this where you are, then we would be very interested in having a conversation with you about how that can be supported and we can be off and running.
And I'll also plug in, I was exploring the website a little bit during the talk, and that has many links about different read out loud options and the books mentioned as well as others. So I certainly encourage everyone to check it out and share with other parents or active community members that you think would be interested.
On that same note, Emily, really quickly, I was reminded of a story. Maybe about 5 years ago, I was invited to talk with the humanist group in my area. And I told them all about our program and I shared some research. And there was a young woman there that day that said to the group, you know, I no longer want to be a keyboard revolutionary. I will never forget that she used that particular phrase. She said, I'm sitting behind my computer, I'm responding to things that I see on social media and on Facebook, and I get so mad about things that people are saying, but I don't want to just be a keyboard revolutionary. I really want to get involved in my community and do something that I think is going to make a difference for the future of our country. And so she became involved in Freedom Readers and has worked with us very closely ever since then. So I just wanted to throw that phrase out because it's stuck in my head. Keyboard revolutionaries are definitely not what we need right now, because we know a lot of kids, when schools shut down because of COVID, many families didn't engage online. There are lots of families that haven't been involved in any formalized education ever since we shut down in March of 2020. So we are going to have to be very creative and innovative about the ways that we can reach those families and those kids, because they still need a strong foundation in literacy.
That is both a great example and a nice tie-in to another question that we have. about how do you encourage kids to be globally curious through the learnings and the stories that they read.
That's kind
of encouraging the next generation to also take more action.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a wonderful question. One of my favorite picture books right now, and I don't have it in my stack right here, it's called Speak Up. And it really is a children's book about how we can use our voices to make the world better. We have a theme that we choose for each one of our 8 to 10 week sessions. And one of our themes was recently about heroes in the world. So we got to read about Malala, and we got to learn about the lengths that she went to just to be educated and all that happened to her. We read about Ruby Bridges, and we saw videos about how she was on the front lines of integrating schools and the dangers that she had to face. And just, we talked about how scared she must have been and the courage that she had to have in that moment. And so by choosing these themes that really reflect things that are important to kids that are sitting right in front of us, things that are not necessarily prepackaged, but just in a response to that receiving that we've done for all of the children who are working in our program, that's how we build that global awareness of the power that each one of those kids has to change the world. And so then we go out and find those books and those videos and those songs that show them an example of what you can do if you're going to be a change agent. And we encourage them to move down that road as well. We teach them about letter writing. That's another reason that we teach them about public speaking, because we believe in social justice. And we believe that doing this work is really a political act. It means that we're standing for the rights of those young people and giving them the access that they need to be able to make the world more equitable. So that was a great question.
Yeah, and you mentioned about looking for books that have better representation of all the different kinds of children out there. I also wonder if, we're seeing more books talk about different issues and as well as identities, so that children kind of understand that they, kind of like a better understanding of the world around them that's true. You know, nothing wrong with make believe in fiction, but really understanding, the communities outside of their neighborhood and the countries that they may not have visited yet, and the cultures that they haven't possibly gotten to in their schoolwork yet. So I don't know if you have thoughts on maybe some other areas you would love for children's books to explore more, or concepts that you think that could get more attention in children's literature.
Mm-hmm. That's a really great question too. That really did remind me of this other book that I had on my stack over here. It's called Kalamata's Kitchen. And this little girl is Indian. And so it talks all about the different kinds of spices that they use in the kitchen. And it also explores a trip that she took with her family to India. And so this is just another one of the books that I really love that I have on my list. I remember very vividly the day that I learned about the Emmanuel 9 and the shooting that happened at Emmanuel AME Church. We are situated about an hour away from that church. And I know that there were a lot of children. There you go, one more time. Kalamata's Kitchen by Sarah Thomas. There you go. And I'll be happy to share with Emily a list of the books that I shared during this talk, if you like. But getting back to your question, Emily, I'm sorry I get distracted a little bit, but I really in that moment know that there were a lot of children that we worked with in our program who watched that story on the news and understood what happened and came to us with a heightened level of anxiety. because that happened. And they couldn't fully grasp why something like that would take place. So I know it's not necessarily an easy thing for a children's book to attack an issue like that. But I think that those are the kinds of things that we have to figure out how to talk about with our kids. Sandy Hook is another thing that I haven't seen any children's books that address Sandy Hook, but I haven't seen all the children's books out there. I just think it's important to be able to have conversations with kids on a level where they're ready to have those conversations, and to be able to address the anxiety that they're carrying and the fear that they feel. And that's another thing that we had to address when it comes to COVID. We had to really talk about, you know, some of the tutors in our program, the people that we know passed away because of COVID. And so these are the conversations that are important. We invite in mental health professionals. Not only are we looking at the books, but the books are a vehicle to be able to help the kids to mature and develop in a healthy way.
One more book that I thought about because I wrote an article about it for thehumanist.com was from called All the Way to the Top. And it's the story about Jennifer Keelan Chaffins, who as a child was part of a big protest in support of the American Disabilities Act. And it's so the book is both celebrating the history, but also encouraging children to understand a little bit more about what they can do to support people with different abilities.
That's wonderful, Emily. I'd love to read your article. I'm going to have to look that up and read more about that book. It just, when you mentioned that, it reminded me of the fact that the tutors in our program often come to me and tell me how much they learn from the sessions that we have together. So children's books are not necessarily just for children. They're so beautifully illustrated and the stories are so simple, but yet the themes are so universal and they just lead us into these very beautiful and rich and complex and multifaceted conversations between the adults and the kids. And so I guess you can tell I'm a sucker for a children's book. I just love it.
No, my mother is too. She's always on the hunt for more. And she loves being able to bring them into different programs. So I think that that's definitely something that you don't need to grow out of. You can, as you were sharing some of your favorites from childhood, there's both the being able to celebrate the books that have aged well that we want to continue and also recognizing the new ones coming out that are sometimes raising more attention than previous books have been. And I think that also as the as more people start purchasing these books, that also gives a message to the publishers that they are needed and wanted and helps also bring them into school curriculum as well.
Yeah, absolutely. I read this researcher many years ago that coined a phrase. She says that kids, and I guess maybe all of us, we need books that are windows into other people's experiences so that we can maybe walk a mile in someone else's shoes. And those books really grow our empathy and help us to understand other people's perspectives. But at the same time, we can't forget that every kid needs books that are mirrors, that show them who they are, that validate who they are and say, you are seen and you are heard and your voice is important and you are very special. And so what I really love about our program is that I think we're able to maybe balance those two things in a, I think in a pretty effective way, especially because we have an adult with one child who's looking to make sure that the scales are always balanced for that child.
So I knew you had mentioned before about this importance of the community supporting children outside of schools, but do you also have some thoughts on how we can support our school system? And we are getting into beginning another year during the pandemic, which means many different things for parents kind of still navigating whether Zoom hybrid in person is best and safest for their children. And wondering if you have any thoughts on what folks who are connected or unconnected to the school system can do.
Mm-hmm. So I think that this is going to be a back to school season like no other. We are facing so many challenges, and people are feeling a range of emotions. At the beginning of the summer, I was confident in my heart that we had turned a corner. You know, I'm vaccinated. I never thought that I'd be wearing my mask again inside. So these are all things that we're thinking about. And I think a lot of us are very anxious about how this is going to turn out. So the first thing that I would say for people who are connected or unconnected to our educational system is we need to be, I think, committed more than ever to holding our elected officials and our school leaders accountable. So we have to really look at the decisions that are being made on behalf of our children. And we have to think about, I mean, we have to be honest about whether or not those decisions are really going to be in the best interest of our kids. And when they're not, we have to be dedicated and courageous and committed to saying, listen, I don't think this is the right path for our kids. I really feel like literacy and education is probably our next frontier in terms of civil rights. And so these kids are, they don't get the right to vote, and we do. And so we really need to look at the records of the people who are making these decisions, and we need to be willing to ask the hard questions. We need to be willing to say to school officials, why is it that I can walk in a school and see that there are more children of color in our special education classes than in our advanced classes? Why is it that I'm seeing that there are more kids of color or kids from low-income communities that are being expelled or suspended than their white counterparts? We need to be willing to just step forward and say, what kinds of books are we offering our kids in the classroom, and why isn't this more balanced? We need to ask those questions and be willing to hold the folks that are in charge accountable.
So I don't see more questions, but I want to thank you again and give you a chance if you want to give any other final thoughts, calls to action for us to wrap up with.
Yeah, I think I'll just say a couple of words about how important it is for us to understand our responsibility. If all of us have been given the privilege of being able to pick up a book, read it, interpret it, understand what message is given to us, then I'm hopeful that we will recognize that one of the best things that we can do for our community, for the future of our world, is to be able to give kids the tools that they need to do that as well. Because there's a record, there's a historical record that I think we need to pass down to them so that they can understand the truth and also embrace their responsibility in our communities and in our societies. So if we've been given that gift, let's be committed to passing that along. And let us not forget that talent is universal, but opportunity is not. And so if we get the chance to open up the gates of opportunity, then let us embrace that.
That is a wonderful note to add on. And I will remind folks to visit freedomreaders.org and check out Tracy's book, which is on the website and has links to more resources There you go, forever free. And thank you all for joining us tonight. We look forward to seeing you again at other events, and I invite you to visit AmericanHumanist.org for more information, to become a member, and to support our work. So have a great rest of your day. Thanks, Tracy.
Thank you. Bye.